Good evening. I'm Amna Nawaz.
And I'm Jeff Bennett. On the NewsHour tonight, former President Donald Trump beats Nikki Haley in New Hampshire, putting him a step closer to once again securing the Republican presidential nomination.
The war in Gaza sees one of its deadliest days yet for Israeli forces as a brutal ground offensive grinds on with civilians caught in the crossfire. We speak to the United Nations' top human rights official.
The central aspect of the tragedy of Gaza, in my view, is the total uncertainty for civilians about what's going to happen to them next.
And the parents of a mass shooter face a manslaughter trial over whether they can be held accountable for their actions and inaction.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. Former President Donald Trump has won the New Hampshire primary, beating former Ambassador Nikki Haley.
The Associated Press called the race for Trump shortly after the last polls closed at 8 p.m. Eastern. You can see the latest results right there. 54% of the vote so far going to former President Donald Trump. That's with just 32% of the expected vote in so far. These numbers could shift slightly as the night goes on, but not enough votes out there for Nikki Haley to close the gap.
And on the Democratic side, President Joe Biden has also won his party's primary. Mr. Biden did not put his name on the New Hampshire ballot because the state went against the Democratic National Committee and held its primary before South Carolina. But the Associated Press has determined a write-in campaign has still given Mr. Biden the most votes this evening.
Our Lisa Desjardins is in Concord, New Hampshire's capital city, at Nikki Haley's election night party. So, Lisa, not the win that the Haley campaign was perhaps hoping for, though there was some expectation setting changing today. But give us a sense of what the mood is in the room and what Haley had to say.
Well, in this chilly New Hampshire night, the Haley supporters have not waited around. She spoke a short time ago. As you can see, the room has emptied since then. Speaking to Haley supporters, some told me they were, of course, disappointed that she didn't win. But Haley, when she spoke, she congratulated Donald Trump, and she said she's not done yet.
Now, you've all heard the chatter among the political class. They're falling all over themselves, saying this race is over. Well, I have news for all of them. New Hampshire is first in the nation. It is not the last in the nation. Well, I'm a fighter. And I'm scrappy. And now we're the last one standing next to Donald Trump.
Haley also said there are dozens of states left to go. Of course, the next state is, as she called it, her sweet South Carolina. She absolutely must do well there. There are questions about how much money remains, of course. How long can she keep going? But tonight, she was projecting the idea that she will stay in this well past South Carolina. As for her supporters, talking about the margin, we've been saying all night that's important. But I caught up with one of the voters here that I talked to a couple nights ago at a Haley event. Big supporter. He said she overperformed.
an incumbent president. That's unprecedented for a new person to arrive on the scene and get the percentages she does. I think she just proved how weak Donald Trump is and what trouble he's in for the fall. I think she did an incredible job of what she did here. She knocked off six different other candidates to get, 46? Where's she at, 45, 46%? That's a huge victory.
Now, I did get some response from the Trump campaign as well. Chris LaCivita, a senior advisor to the Donald Trump campaign, tells me they expect to win by double digits ultimately. We'll see how that goes tonight. But he also sent me this. He said, despite the record Democrats and unaffiliated turnout tonight, Donald Trump still posted a decisive win that should be a real worry to Joe Biden. It is important to say that what Nikki Haley does is very important for Joe Biden. On this campaign trail, Amna and Jeff, it has been clear to me that Joe Biden stands more to lose. More of his voters would vote for Nikki Haley than for Donald Trump. Many of them voted for her tonight. And some of them telling me they initially voted for Nikki Haley as a protest vote for Donald Trump. But by the end, these Democrats told me they would pick her over Joe Biden. So a Trump win might sound strange in one way, might be good for Joe Biden down the road. All of these strange dynamics in this unusual New Hampshire primary.
Well, let's talk a bit more about President Biden, Lisa, because he won the Democratic contest with a strong write-in campaign, and that was driven by a group of grassroots Democrats who say they were unaffiliated with the official re-election campaign. Tell us how they pulled that off.
That's right. This was an extraordinary campaign. You had folks in New Hampshire who had been leading Democrats, one who had been a gubernatorial nominee, just gathered over a Zoom call late last year, six of them, and decided they were concerned that if some other Democrat won the New Hampshire primary, that that would start a snowball effect, a lack of motivation, a lack of enthusiasm, the media would say, for Joe Biden. They wanted instead to show that Joe Biden has grassroots support. So over that Zoom call, they gathered together. The actual write-in Joe Biden campaign ended up raising and spending somewhere under $100,000. There is an affiliated super PAC that has much more money, $1 million or so. But it's all to say that this is an extraordinary and rare effort for any strong Democrat, but especially an incumbent president. Texting with me right now, one of those organizers says, I'm told that Democratic turnout today is twice what it was in 2012. When an incumbent, Barack Obama, was running. So the write-in Biden campaign, very happy with what they see in these numbers. They like these strong margins that they're getting. But at the same time, Jeff, Dean Phillips, those in his campaign are telling me they also like what they're seeing. They believe he will end the night over 20%. And they think that that is a strong statement that many Democrats, a fifth of Democrats in this state, or who voted with Democrats, reject Joe Biden. So both sides here seems a reason to continue on. I think this debate in the Democratic Party over Joe Biden does not end here in New Hampshire.
All right, that is Lisa Desjardins at the Haley headquarters in Concord, New Hampshire for us tonight. Lisa, thanks so much. To break down what we're seeing in New Hampshire tonight, we're joined now by our panel of political analysts. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter, Democratic strategist Faz Shakir, who was the campaign manager for Bernie Sanders' presidential campaign, and Republican strategist Kevin Madden, who advised Mitt Romney's presidential campaign. It's great to have you all here. Amy, we heard Nikki Haley say today that she's not getting out of this race. She said New Hampshire is the first in the nation, not the last in the nation. Where does she go from here and how?
Well, she talked about going to South Carolina, which she's right, that is her home. But polls that have been taken, at least in the last week or so, suggest that this is an even tougher state for her, even though she was the governor, even though she still lives there, that this is just an electorate that is more attached to Donald Trump. Unlike a New Hampshire or an Iowa, the political establishment, the governor, the delegation, the congressional delegation, all have endorsed Donald Trump there, including Congresswoman Nancy Mace, who is Nikki Haley's own congresswoman. Right. So this is the kind of pressure is going to be much harder, and the bar is going to be much higher in South Carolina. It's also a month away. That's a long time in politics. So, you know, when you have a win, if she won tonight and you could take that, it's sort of like rocket fuel to raise you money and raise your profile and give you that sort of boost for a month. Now she's got to try to trudge along, keep making the case that South Carolina is going to change. Maybe these results will change the numbers in South Carolina, but I don't know that we're going to see much movement.
Before we dig into some of the details of how Haley performed tonight, do you agree with Amy's assessment of Haley's path forward, Ken?
I do, and you know, I've been in that position where I've had to explain a second place finish as a win, trying to, you know, gain some momentum or put a good spin on a campaign performance. But I think Amy's most important point is the next month is going to feel like an eternity for Nikki Haley's campaign. The reality here is that the Trump campaign is much better positioned for a one-on-one contest than Nikki Haley's campaign is. So all of their firepower, their surrogates, their resources are going to be trained on getting Nikki Haley out of the race. And, you know, a week, 2 weeks from now, we don't see any big change in numbers, and this race remains static, which is a convincing Donald Trump lead in all of the early primary states. It's very unlikely that we're going to see Nikki Haley be able to continue on and face actual voters in South Carolina in the end of February.
I just want to get your take on some of the results we had coming in about how people voted on the ground in New Hampshire. If we take a look at moderate voters, and this is according to the Associated Press voter surveys, when you look at her performance here, Kevin, yeah, she did win the moderate vote in New Hampshire, but that margin, is that what tells you she just didn't do as well as she could have here?
That's a good performance. She has done a good job of reaching out to very pragmatic conservatives, pragmatic independents on the issues that matter and convincing people that she's the right candidate. But Donald Trump is actually managing those margins. Mm-hmm. He's actually still competitive with moderate voters. A lot of people would say, oh, you know, this many moderate voters came out, Nikki Haley has a better chance. But it's clear that a lot of these voters that are moderates are actually now, again, we talked about this earlier, becoming resigned to the fact that Donald Trump is probably going to be the nominee. And so she just doesn't have that contrast or a convincing lead amongst those voters and other key demographics inside the party to really continue and soldier on.
Fess, how do you see it? And we also heard Nikki Haley say in her speech tonight, she says, the worst kept secret in politics is how badly the Democrats want to run against Donald Trump. They know Trump is the only Republican in this country Joe Biden can defeat. Is she right?
Well, I think we could defeat Nikki Haley as well. So I would be happy to have her as the general election nominee if she were to move forward. But I do think it's going to be Trump. And I'm not on Nikki Haley's payroll, but when I look at some of the numbers, I think Amy was absolutely right that South Carolina is a huge slog for her, despite it having been a state that she governed at one point. I got to think, if I were them, I'd look past it. You got to find a place you could win. When you look at the demographics and the turnout in New Hampshire, it was a moderate state, right? Where can you replicate that? You look down the map, you got to look past South Carolina if you're Nikki Haley. You got to look to a place like Michigan. Michigan is next up, 1 week later. Then you've got 16 states on a Super Tuesday, 3 days after Michigan. I mean, you got to start projecting that you're putting all your eggs in certain baskets and picking those baskets wisely, because otherwise, Donald Trump campaign, they'd be happy to suck you into a fight in South Carolina and take all your money. But if you're Nikki Haley and you're raising money right now and you got to be thinking about where do I want to tell the press, where do I want to tell the nation, how I'm going to extend this race and where I could beat Donald Trump, that's not clear. I don't know what state it could be, but I don't think it's going to be South Carolina.
Does she have the infrastructure and the funding to support that, staying in?
Well, see, now I think you do want to see if she can get any grassroots donations off of this, and obviously super PAC support that she's been able to have up to this point. Will that metastasize? I don't know. I think it could. But you got to give them a strategy, and there isn't one right now. And that's where I think I don't see them wrestling with it, because South Carolina is just, it seems like a dead end zone for them. And I'm happy to see this play out as a Democrat. I'd like this to continue on. So I offer this with all of those intentions in place.
Amy, can I get your take on the Dem side as well, though? Because Lisa mentioned Dean Phillips' potential performance tonight,
yeah,
breaking 20% there. President Joe Biden did win,
right,
as a write-in candidate,
right,
there, but there is this base level of discontent among the Democratic electorate that doesn't seem to go away.
Well, that was the concern from Biden folks, was that, as Lisa mentioned, that if he has a really poor showing, the comparisons to 1968 will come up. And that's when Lyndon Johnson was a write-in candidate, only got 48% of the vote, Eugene McCarthy getting 42%. And then Lyndon Johnson drops out a month later. It's not going to be that close. And so for Phillips, the real question about whether there's some there would have been getting looking more like either 1968 or 1992 when Pat Buchanan came in a close second, but to an incumbent president, holding George H.W. Bush to 53%. That hasn't happened either. Now, he is on the ballot in South Carolina. South Carolina Democratic primary is on a different day. It's actually coming up on February 3rd. So this is where we can do an apples-to-apples comparison. And remember, part of the reason New Hampshire was upset with Joe Biden is because they changed the calendar. New Hampshire wasn't first. South Carolina's first. So let's see what that looks like there. Again, Joe Biden's not going to lose the vote, in South Carolina, but let's see if that enthusiasm is there, and let's see if Lisa's source was correct that the turnout on the Democratic side ends up being stronger than expected.
Returning to this AP voter survey, there's a question that they asked some of the voters. It says, regardless of who you support, which candidate do you think will win the Republican nomination for president? 68% of those surveyed said Donald Trump, 27% said Nikki Haley. And Kevin, this speaks to the point you made earlier about the air of inevitability around Donald Trump, who has all the advantages of being a de facto incumbent and running that way.
Yeah, this was the biggest challenge, again, that Nikki Haley faced since Iowa, which is that a lot of people like Nikki Haley. They think she's run a good race. You see in a lot of the verbatims from many of the voters out there, they're saying that, you know, she came from nowhere to compete with an incumbent, a nominally incumbent presidential candidate. And so they're appreciative of her efforts in New Hampshire and what she's brought to the party, but they're just resigned to the fact that Donald Trump is going to be the nominee. And so that is, again, I think that's something she's going to encounter in South Carolina and Florida and all these other states should she try to continue. It's a very real obstacle in her way right now.
Fez, I gotta ask you about the issues that people say are the top issue for them, because this surprised me in Iowa, it surprised me again tonight in New Hampshire. The number one issue that Republican primary voters said mattered to them was immigration, followed by the economy and jobs, and then lower down the list, abortion and health care and so on. What does that say to you about how this general election is going to play out?
Well, I think when you look at the issue of immigration, I think it means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. You look at, I think, a majority of Republicans voters and a lot of Democratic voters, they think of immigration as an economy issue. They're worried that, you know, are immigrants coming and taking our jobs, stripping our social safety net, driving down wages. For whatever you feel about how the issue is playing, they link those two together. And I think, you know, it's also a national security issue. It's a safety issue. It's a fentanyl issue. It's a drugs issue. So I do think that we get a little too siloed in these issue boxes of forgetting how people see the effects in their community when they're ripped by drugs, when they're ripped by cost of living issues. They are finding connections with an immigration issue.
That one word means so much more.
That's right.
I agree with that. And I think it's also a competence issue, looking at a president who has a crisis and how does that president address that crisis? And a lot of folks would say, including Democrats, not particularly well. And so it speaks to their feelings about Biden.
My view on this, my advice to the president is no one thinks you're going to solve it. I mean, this damn thing's been going on for decades now. It's very hard to solve. But they want to know, are you running away from it or do you acknowledge it? Do you see it? Mm-hmm. Do you recognize its importance in our lives? And do you want to talk about it?
Yeah, a resonant issue indeed.
Talking about it a lot more.
Yeah.
Shakir, Amy Walter, Kevin Madden, thank you to you all. We're going to see you all back here shortly for our special live coverage. It's right here on PBS or online, and that is beginning at 11 p.m. Eastern.
In the day's other headlines, Houthi rebels in Yemen again expressed defiance after another round of Western airstrikes. The Iranian-backed militants said they'll go on attacking ships in the Red Sea in solidarity with Palestinians in Gaza. The U.S. and Britain retaliated with fighter jets and missiles last night in their second joint strike inside Yemen. They hit 8 sites, but today Houthi supporters in Sana'a brushed aside the attacks.
The U.S. airstrikes are like a spray of water for a thirsty person. I swear it will not scare us or turn a hair on our heads. In response to the destruction of Gaza and the killing of innocent people, they will see anger, burning fire, and flames.
Pentagon officials said the strikes have destroyed more than 25 missile launching sites and 20 missiles. And late today, the U.S. military carried out strikes inside Iraq on militia fighters backed by Iran. It followed attacks on American troops in Iraq and Syria. Waves of Russian missiles killed 18 people in Ukraine today and injured more than 130. It was one of the largest one-day death tolls in weeks. More than 40 missiles pounded Kharkiv and Kyiv. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said they hit more than 200 sites, including scores of residential buildings. The United Nations reports more than 10,000 civilians have been killed in Ukraine in nearly 2 years of war. Negotiators in the U.S. Senate said today they are inching closer to a deal on new military aid for Ukraine and changes in U.S. border policy. Still, there was no timetable for reaching an agreement. One negotiator, Democrat Chris Murphy, acknowledged reports that Ukrainian troops are being forced to conserve ammunition, giving the Russians an advantage.
That is a recipe for disaster. That is a recipe for Kyiv to be a Russian city sometime soon. The whole world is watching and asking a simple question. Does the United States stand up for its friends?
President Biden wants $61 billion for Ukraine's military. Republicans have tied that request to demands for better U.S. southern border security. In California, a one-day strike by professors and staff in the state university system is over. They took to the picket lines Monday, just as the new semester was getting underway. More than 450,000 students on 23 campuses were affected. Late last night, the two sides announced a deal including salary hikes and longer parental leave with pay. The 2024 Academy Award nominations are out, and Oppenheimer leads the pack with 13. Christopher Nolan's three-hour feature about the creation of the atomic bomb is now a frontrunner for Best Picture. It's also nominated for Best Director and Acting Awards. The year's biggest moneymaker, Barbie, received 8 nominations, but Greta Gerwig was left out of the Best Director category. On Wall Street, corporate profit reports lifted much of the market, but not the blue chips. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 96 points to close at 37,905. The NASDAQ rose 65 points. The S&P 500 was up 14. And award-winning CBS News journalist Charles Osgood died today at his home in New Jersey. He anchored the TV network's Sunday morning show for 22 years, and his daily segment, The Osgood File, ran on radio for more than 4 decades. Along the way, he became known as the network's poet in residence, rendering stories in comical verse. Charles Osgood was 91 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, the UN's top humanitarian official on the growing crisis in Gaza, how the rise of artificial intelligence is boosting tech stocks, and a Pakistani artist finds success painting his personal experience.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Israel's military announced today that nearly 24 soldiers were killed yesterday fighting in Gaza, the deadliest day for Israel since Hamas's October 7th terrorist attacks. Israel's government vowed to continue the war amid fierce fighting, caught in between tens of thousands of Palestinian civilians. In a moment, Nick Schifrin speaks with the UN's humanitarian chief about conditions in Gaza, but first, his report on this deadly day for Israel's defense forces.
A prayer for the dead. A family grappling with grief. Sergeant First Class Hadar Kapuluk was a 23-year-old reservist killed in Gaza yesterday. Sergeant Major Alai Levy was from the same unit. Today, his mother said a final goodbye, and his father delivered a message of determination.
Let's show our enemies that we are strong, and even in such a difficult situation, we do not break. Please say with me 3 times, the people of Israel live.
Am Israel high! Am Israel high! Am Israel high!
An Israeli officer described how 21 reservists died in the destroyed building behind him. The 261st Brigade was preparing to demolish the building with their own explosives when a Palestinian militant opened fire, said Israeli Army spokesman Rear Admiral Daniel Hagari.
The first rocket hit one of the buildings in which explosives had been laid out. The hit apparently led to the explosion that caused the collapse of the building and the collapse of the building next to it.
The fighting is most intense in southern Gaza on Hamas's home turf, literally. Hamas video shows a fighter firing from a bedroom window. And Hamas fighters shooting from inside blown-out buildings, aiming at Israeli soldiers in buildings across the way. Israeli military video shows soldiers in close combat and exposing what Israel says is a Hamas tunnel next to Khan Yunis schools. Today, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu vowed victory.
Together we will fight, and God willing, together we will win.
In southern Gaza, victims of the war arrive by donkey cart. Ahed Masma, in green, bears no relation to the victims. He was, instead, the bearer of bodies he found near his home. He brought them here to try and give dignity to the dead.
Seeing them gives one chills. No matter how hard it was, we would have brought them, even if there was an aircraft above us wanting to target us.
Others are caught in an endless cycle of displacement, fleeing farther and farther south into less and less land.
Where do we go? This is the 17th time I've left my home. Where should I go?
The UN says 1.7 million of Gaza's 2.2 million residents are currently displaced. To discuss the humanitarian situation in Gaza, but also other humanitarian crises around the world, we turn to Martin Griffiths, the UN Undersecretary General for Humanitarian Affairs and Emergency Relief Coordinator. Martin Griffiths, thanks very much. Welcome back to the NewsHour. Let's start in Gaza. The WFP said today that very little food aid has traveled into central and northern Gaza and that there is still a risk of famine. How serious is that risk?
It's a very serious risk. And what's quite striking about it is how quickly the move to possible famine is going in Gaza if you compare it to other parts of the world. We estimate maybe 400,000 people are seriously at risk of famine. Moving aid around in Gaza is, in all practical terms, impossible. Getting food to these people since October 7th has been very, very difficult. It's a very, very rapid decline, and it's very worrying.
Today, the Israeli government spokesman, Ilan Levy, said that there are, quote, no limitations on humanitarian aid, and he added this.
It is lamentable that UN officials who have also been covering up for the fact that Hamas hijacks aid and covering up for the fact that it wages war out of hospitals are trying to cover up their own systemic failure by demanding the opening of new entry routes when there is already adequate and excess capacity at the existing ones.
What's your response to that statement?
I think it's extremely unfair. I think it's wrong to suggest that we don't need more entry points. But most importantly, if the conditions inside Gaza, the operational conditions, don't exist for the distribution of aid, don't blame us for that. They result from the conflict, and they include safety of movement. They include roads which are not mined. They include assurances that places that we will deliver aid to won't be attacked. They include hospitals that are not places of war. They include not taking out of our trucks when they're being screened on the way in. So I don't think it's right to blame humanitarian agencies for what is a very, very, very difficult operation.
You mentioned hospitals. Hamas operates near hospitals and has fired rockets near hospitals. The U.S. and Israel accuses Hamas of using hospitals as command and control. And in southern Gaza, just in the last few days, we have seen Israeli forces surrounding at least two hospitals. What are your concerns for the patients in those hospitals and also the displaced Gazans who use the hospitals as a refuge place?
Hospitals are protected under international humanitarian law and should not ever be used by military forces from wherever they come, from whichever party, Hamas included, as places of refuge or operation, of operational bases. So to have a situation where the few hospitals that still continue to exist, where the patients find themselves in the middle of a war zone, where entry into and exit out of is through fighting, is, of course, a terrible, terrible thing to see and a terrible stain on our humanity. And if that is because Hamas is sheltering there, then they should not do so. The central aspect of the tragedy of Gaza in my view, is the total uncertainty for civilians about what's going to happen to them next. Where will they be? Where can they find food? Will there be safety? Where can that be found? And the hospital example, if you like, of that encapsulates that sense of absolute danger and uncertainty about the future.
I want to shift to Yemen, where 9 years of war has caused what you and I used to talk about as the world's worst humanitarian crisis. Over the last few months, Houthi rebels have launched more than 30 attacks at international ships, both commercial and warships. And in the last 10 or so days, the U.S., U.K., and an international consortium have launched 8 strikes on Houthis in Yemen. Do you fear the violence could derail the progress that has been made toward a political settlement between the Houthis and, on the other side, the Saudi-backed international coalition that you were right in the middle of for many years?
I am totally, totally concerned about that. Yes, Nick, the people of Yemen have waited long enough and have glimpsed in the recent weeks the possibility of a ceasefire and an end to this tragic, unnecessary, and brutal war. And suddenly to find it at huge risk, possibly taken away, is just too depressing. I think it would be very difficult for the Saudis and their allies to continue to ignore a Houthi aggression into the Red Sea. At the moment, it's still kind of more or less not being allowed to get out of hand, if I could put it that way. But I don't see that lasting. The Saudis got to the point with the Houthis of elaborating a plan for a ceasefire in some detail with some associated advantages for the people of Yemen. It was close to moving on to the next phase. Suddenly, to see that snatched away, that's just so unjust.
You recently released the humanitarian appeal for Ukraine, where some 40% of the population needs aid. That's 14.6 million people, and you're asking for $3.1 billion. Are you getting what you need for the people of Ukraine?
Well, we're not getting what we need for the people anywhere, not as it were, even in Ukraine. What was depressing about launching that plan the other day was simply to think that now we're so close to entering the third year of that war, what the Secretary General of the United Nations clearly decided to label a war, and it is a war against the people of Ukraine. Now, I think Ukraine is going to be another sad, sad story. And the fact of the matter is that Gaza, it has moved Ukraine out of the center of the story. Ukraine and Gaza have moved Sudan out of the center of the story. And you remember there was a place called Afghanistan we used to talk about that hasn't got resolved yet.
You went even further when we were talking earlier. You used the phrase, a year as depressing as this one. How depressing, from your perspective?
I cannot remember a year which is so full of crisis and most particularly, a world where leaders often choose war first as an instrument to resolve differences. We have spent the last 75 years building the new international order, norms, regulations, rules of diplomacy, efforts to keep the peace, efforts to emphasize the need for negotiation first. And in this last year or two, we've begun to see that disappear, to vanish. And that's why I think we call this the age of wars, because it really is. War is the first instrument for many people. And it's a savage one because the people who suffer, as we were discussing at the top of the piece, are the civilians who have had nothing to do with those decisions.
Martin Griffiths, Under Secretary General for Humanitarian Affairs and Emergency Relief Coordinator, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Nick. Thanks for having me on.
A trial started in Michigan today seeking to answer a difficult question. Can parents be held responsible when their child commits a mass shooting? In this particular case, the teenage shooter has already been convicted. But as William Brangham reports, officials are also seeking to prosecute his parents in a case that could break new legal ground.
On November 30th, 2021, tragedy came to snowy Oxford High School in Michigan. A student opened fire, killing four students, injuring seven others. The gunman, then 15-year-old Ethan Crumley, received a life sentence last year. But now, his parents, James and Jennifer Crumley, face their own charges of involuntary manslaughter. It is a first-of-its-kind effort to hold parents criminally responsible for a school shooting done by their child.
This case is unprecedented in Oakland County and perhaps the state.
Prosecutors say the Crumleys knew Ethan was troubled, but acted negligently. James Crumley bought for his son the gun he used to kill his classmates. Concerns flagged by the school went unheeded. The day before the shooting, on November 29th, Oxford High informed Jennifer Crumley that her son was looking up ammunition on his phone. She texted him, "LOL, I'm not mad. You have to learn not to get caught." Hours before the shooting began, teachers discovered this worksheet on Ethan's desk, covered with violent warning signs. Below a drawing of a gun, he wrote, "The thoughts won't stop, help me," and "blood everywhere," and a drawing of a bullet. When a teacher saw the sheet, he scratched much of it out, including what appears to be a shooting victim, dripping with blood.
Ethan's parents were called into school that morning, but officials say they resisted taking him home and made no mention of any gun. Shortly after they left, their son began his rampage. When news of the shooting got out in the community, Jennifer Crumley texted her son, writing, "Ethan, don't do it." But it was too late.
Karen McDonald is the Oakland County prosecutor.
The notion that a parent could read those words and also know that their son had access to a deadly weapon that they gave him is unconscionable, and I think it's criminal.
The defense claims the Crumleys had no way of knowing how troubled their son really was. Both have pleaded not guilty.
For more on this case and its broader implications, I am joined by Echo Yonka. He's the Thomas M. Cooley Professor of Law at the University of Michigan. Professor Yonka, thank you so much for being back on the NewsHour. I mean, as a scholar of the law, what do you make of this case? I mean, it is not that common that we hold other people responsible for the actions of another.
No, that's exactly right. In fact, one of the first things you learn as a 1L law student in criminal law and other fields is that even under some really awful facts, when other people take action, that, as we say, severs the causal chain. It makes it not your action. You know, it's a classic example in first year law school to say that if you give somebody a gun and they threaten to kill themselves and you give them the gun, you encourage them to kill themselves and they do, you're not responsible. So even under odious circumstances, you're typically not responsible. That being said, one of the things we do to our law students is push them on how far these examples can go. How terrible do I have to make the facts? How odious do I have to make it? How close to the edge before you finally say the law has to give? And the truth is, if I was coming up with an exam question, I couldn't come up with facts that were more upsetting, more cutting, and seemingly more disturbing than the ones we have in this case.
Given all of that about the law, what do you think are the biggest challenges facing the prosecution trying to prosecute this case?
So I think there are two challenges. The one we already spoke about is just the kind of bedrock legal principle. And that's something that is deep in our legal culture. That is, human beings are responsible for their own actions. And so the prosecution here is going to be going up against what every judge, what every other lawyer has learned, what every defense lawyer has learned, and what they're going to be conveying to the jury as our bedrock principle. But setting aside the legal machinations, there's also just what the law reflects, the kind of moral intuition that we aren't responsible when other people do bad things. And that's going to be true even when these facts are heartbreaking, because you're going to have people thinking about, you know, of course I'm doing my best to be a great parent. Of course I'm trying to bring my child up to be successful and flourishing. But what if you have a child who's difficult, problematic, has shoplifted, gets in fights at school? I think quite outside of the dry technical legal language, there are going to be a lot of people out there who just think, when 13, 16, 17, 18, when will it be the case that I can't be held responsible, no matter the best I do for my child, for their abhorrent behavior?
Does the fact that Michigan passed a law that in essence makes it a crime for you not to secure a gun and a minor gets access to that, doesn't that imply sort of de facto that what these parents did at the time wasn't against the law?
Well, you're certainly right that in the wake of highly visible events, we often pass laws. And that is by some people going to be taken as a defense. But of course, sometimes we pass laws to make our legal responsibilities more clear or to help fill a lacuna. And to be perfectly honest, criminal law scholars know that we often pass laws just to add penalties to things that are already illegal. So for example, I remember when Philadelphia passed an anti-carjacking statute. It was frankly an opportunity for public officials to say we're doing something about it. But nobody really thinks that before that law was passed, carjacking was legal. So of course they'll make the argument that this wasn't illegal when it happened, but the prosecutor's gonna argue that this was criminally negligent, even under the slew of statutes they had before this specific law was passed.
I mean, this prosecutor has made it very clear that she hopes that this will spur other gun owners basically to do a better job of securing their firearms. And I'm just curious if you think that if this prosecution is successful, that this will spur other prosecutors in other states, maybe elsewhere in the country, to take on similar cases.
Look, the law lives on precedent, and I certainly think it's the case, as you said, that given that we have this kind of deep legal intuition that you're never going to be responsible for somebody else's acts, a successful prosecution in a highly visible and painful case of a school shooting is going to rocket across the country. It's not an accident that it'll be on PBS, on all the major news channels. And that will give prosecutors one more tool in their arsenal. Because of the nature of precedent, and because any time you do something unprecedented, legal actors are going to take notice, I think there's no question that prosecutors are going to use this as a tool. Sadly, we should also admit these cases are incredibly painful and incredibly visible and all too repetitive. And so the fact that there's a successful prosecution in this case, if there's a successful prosecution in this case, there'll almost certainly be another.
All right. Echo Yonka, professor of law at the University of Michigan, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Rallies have driven both the Dow Jones Industrial Average and the much larger S&P 500 to record highs this week. There are several reasons for that, including investors' assessments of the economy right now and where it will be in the months ahead. We're going to break this all down with David Gura, business correspondent for NPR, who's been watching all of this carefully. David, it's great to have you here. So how much is the market rally connected to investors' expectations that the Fed is going to cut rates pretty soon?
Yeah, it's hugely tied to that, Jeff. And we got this indication last year from the Federal Reserve that they were looking to make cuts in 2023. There's been some recalibration recent days of expectations of how soon markets think the Fed is going to actually do that, lower those rates. But they're looking around, investors are looking around and seeing a bevy of economic indicators that are looking pretty strong. And they have this belief that the Federal Reserve, despite what seemed like small odds at the beginning of last year, the year before, are going to be able to engineer this so-called soft landing, that they're going to get high inflation under control without triggering recession, and that's certainly buoying the stock market. Now, I should say the gains haven't been widely shared. They certainly weren't last year, which ended up being a much stronger year for stocks than I think a lot of people expected in light of what I was just talking about, that being this fear that we could hit a recession. So we haven't had broad-based gains, but stocks have been performing much better, I think, than Wall Street expected at the beginning of last year.
And there's also a lot of investor enthusiasm about artificial intelligence. How has the promise of AI reordered the markets and really fueled the returns of the so-called Magnificent Seven? These are the high-performing tech companies whose stocks typically do really well.
Yeah, Jeff, this was a huge turning point last year. So you mentioned the Magnificent Seven. This is a name that was coined by Michael Hartnett, who's an investment strategist at Bank of America. He allowed that he's a fan of this Western movie from 1960 starring Yul Brynner and Eli Wallach, which is why he named them. But the seven stocks are Alphabet, Amazon, Apple, Meta, Microsoft, NVIDIA, and Tesla. And as you say, these are tech companies, most of which are tied to AI or interested in AI or doing work on AI. I guess Tesla is kind of the exception to that. NVIDIA at the other extreme, this is a company that is designing most of the microchips that are used in the supercomputers that are powering the technology that allows companies to use AI. So they have really outperformed the market. You know, last year, the S&P 500 was up 24%. Those seven stocks, they rose by more than 100% last year. So they've been carrying a lot of the weight here. And there are a number of reasons for that. AI is part of it. Another just has to do with the fact that these are companies that are ingrained in our lives, that we use every day, that they would have staying power if there are going to be some sort of economic downturn. And finally, you know, they have a lot of cash on hand. We're at a point where interest rates are higher than they were for a really long time. A lot of companies, if they want to expand, have to borrow money. They'd have to borrow money at a higher interest rate. These are seven companies that wouldn't have to do that because they have so much money on hand, Jeff.
And yet there are these influential voices injecting notes of caution, namely J.P. Morgan CEO Jamie Dimon, who says, look, there are all sorts of financial and geopolitical risks on the horizon. Here's what he said to CNBC earlier.
I think it's a mistake to assume that everything's hunky-dory. And, you know, and when stock markets are up, it's kind of like this little drug we all feel. Like, it's just great, you know. But remember, we've had so much fiscal and monetary stimulation, so I'm a little more on the cautious side. That we are facing a lot of things in 24 or 25. And we mentioned Ukraine, the terrorist activity in Israel, the Red Sea, quantitative tightening, which I still question if we understand exactly how that works. I don't think we do.
I mean, he's got a point. Why isn't the market apparently taking into account a host of geopolitical crises and the shipping challenges that result from it and all of the knock-on effects to the stock market and the economy potentially?
It's a really good question, Jeff, and I think that these are all things that are worrying to some investors. I think they're kind of inured to the fact that we've been able to get through a lot of tumult and crises in recent months. But Jamie Dimon stands out as the head of the largest bank in this country and somebody who is more frank and forthright about the prospect of these risks than I think a lot of executives are. You heard him there mentioning Ukraine, the war in Israel. These are topics that he returns to time and time again because he's sort of looking at history with a really broad breadth and fearing that this could have a big effect, not just on the economy, but on sort of the geopolitical system in the world as well. So he's raising alarm about this. I think a lot of people listen to Jamie Dimon again because he's running such a large institution. But so far, we've seen markets kind of shrug that off. You know, you look at what's happening in the Red Sea. We've seen shipping companies pull their ships out of that waterway, send them on a 10-day journey around Africa to avoid that conflict there. We're beginning to see effects of this tumult, and I think it's something that, of course, Wall Street's going to continue to watch here in the days and weeks to come.
And we should be clear, the stock market is not the economy. But you could argue that because of a number of factors, what happens on Wall Street is really intertwined with what happens on Main Street. Do you see it that way?
Yeah, it's important to look at these as discrete things, but you're absolutely right. What we're seeing right now in the stock market is confirmation of the fact that the economy is doing pretty well, again, better than I think a lot of people expected it would be. So you look at the data points that we've gotten recently, look at retail sales. Those came in stronger than expected. We're going to get some figures on GDP, on growth later this week. Another indication on inflation. We've seen the labor market remain really strong and resolute. What we're seeing is the market really embrace each of those economic data points, Jeff. It's kind of confirming this sentiment, this sense that the economy is doing well. And as we saw in a big survey of consumer sentiment last week, a lot of people, yes, investors, but consumers, the rest of us as well, are feeling more confident in the direction of the U.S. economy.
David Gura of NPR. David, always great to speak with you. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Jeff. Thanks.
Pakistani-born artist Salman Tour saw his career take off ever since he made a sudden shift to painting what he's lived, felt, and sometimes even feared. He gave special correspondent Jared Bowen of GBH Boston a tour of his ongoing exhibit. It's for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
The paintings of Salman Tour are about worlds. Worlds of lovers, of friends out on the town, and of family. But in these works, often enveloped in an emerald haze, there's even more at play. Some ecstasy here, some danger there, and in pieces like Back Lawn, there's a labyrinth of layers.
You know, there are many novels and movies about houses like this, and I wanted to kind of take the story of the family as the background of another story, which was going to be in the foreground, which doesn't usually get told.
Front and center here, steps away from what could be a Pakistani family like his own, two men are entwined under a tent.
So instead of being like a moment of fear and hiding, it's more like everything else is in the background, really. And this is actually the real story.
Call it No Ordinary Love, the title of this show exhibiting Tor's most recent work at Brandeis University's Rose Art Museum outside Boston.
Maybe about 3 or 4 years ago, I decided to make semi-autobiographical paintings that were about being more out as a gay man through my paintings than I was before.
They're a far cry from growing up in his native Pakistan, and from his early work, when Tor labored over paintings inspired by 17th and 18th century masters. Coming out artistically meant coming into his own and launching into these largely nocturnal notions of queer life.
There's something very bold and edgy about the works. Drop-dead beautiful, also painful, but very tender.
Ganit Ankhori is the museum's director and has been watching Tor's rise in the art world, especially since his first solo exhibition at New York's Whitney Museum in 2020.
He found a visual vocabulary that articulates the life of a queer brown man living between his homeland and diaspora and creating a community and visualizing that community on his own terms.
One that mostly unfolds a world away from Pakistan, where homosexuality is punished by law, but where Tor found safety and camaraderie among queer friends in his high school art room.
We were all queer, we were all out to each other, and in an environment that was pretty harsh otherwise, I think that we were able to create a very magical space.
That magic dances through his paintings, featuring close-knit friends at bars, in cars, and hanging at home. Their joy swelling in a series he's titled Fag Puddles, reappropriating a hate-filled word into something
like a fabulous heap of like exhaustion. And to me, it's fun to kind of fill it, that heap, with objects that are fun to paint for me and that I'm thinking about, like a feather boa or, you know, or laundry. Anything that's really fun, like a disco ball or something.
Hate and danger creep into Tor's work. It's a residue of the fear he felt as a queer man in Pakistan and a reflection of the anti-LGBTQ+ violence escalating here in the U.S. But rendering it on the canvas, Tor says, is therapeutic.
It's a way to seize control back and to be able to be the master of that narrative.
Which is why we also find a lot of comic relief in his paintings. Figures with Pinocchio-like noses, cartoonish hair, and rubbery limbs.
I do have a sense of humor as a person. I don't take myself that seriously. And I do take my work seriously. So it's important to me that the works about any kind of pain or suffering doesn't get bogged down in any kind of one-dimensional pity or sanctimoniousness of any kind.
Pain is often drowned out in this show by love. If Tor's paintings are a novel, there is a meaningful chapter on family. In this work titled The Women, we see a boy lingering around the warm, gossipy exchanges of his mother and aunts. Tor still owns it and won't let it go, he says, because it's too rooted in memory.
It's someone kind of looking at themselves, maybe in a deeper way in the mirror in that moment than they do usually. And it's a moment, I feel like, in which someone finds themselves beautiful in a mirror.
It's also a portrait of the artist as a young man on the verge of launching into a world all his own. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jared Bowen in Waltham, Massachusetts.
And join us later tonight for more live coverage of the New Hampshire primary results. That's beginning at 11 p.m. Eastern right here on PBS. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz.
And I'm Jeff Bennett. We'll see you here later tonight.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
pediatric surgeon, volunteer, topiary artist, a Raymond James financial advisor, tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
Consumer Cellular, this is Sam.
How may I help you?
This is a pocket dial. Well, somebody's pocket.
Thought I'd let you know that with Consumer Cellular,
you get nationwide coverage with no contract. That's kind of our thing.
Have a nice day.
Cunard is a proud supporter of public television. On a voyage with Cunard, the world awaits. A world of flavor, diverse destinations, and immersive experiences. A world of leisure and British style. All with Cunard's White Star service.
Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.